Hello, this is Dr. Grande. Today's question is, can I analyze the case of David Cash Jr., who is also known as the Bad Samaritan? Just a reminder, I'm not diagnosing anybody in this video, only speculating about what could be happening in a situation like this. If you enjoyed this video, please like it, subscribe to my channel, and consider supporting me on Patreon. I will put the link to Patreon in the description for this video. Also consider purchasing my latest book, Harm Reduction. It is available anywhere books are sold. I will start with the background of this case, move to the timeline of the crime, then offer my analysis. In the spring of 1997, David Cash Jr. lived in Long Beach, California. The 17-year-old had just graduated from high school and was getting ready to enroll at the University of California, Berkeley. In the early morning hours of May 25, David and an 18-year-old friend of his named Jeremy Strohmeyer were at a casino in Las Vegas. David's father was with them. He was gambling as the teenagers were playing video games in the casino arcade. Not far from them was a 7-year-old girl named Charisse Iverson. She was there with her father, Leroy Iverson, and her 14-year-old brother, who was also in the arcade. Leroy was drinking and gambling. He was not attentive to Charisse. Security at the casino had returned Charisse to Leroy several times that day because she was left unattended. Leroy would later claim that he didn't have enough money for a hotel room. He figured his kids could play in the arcade. He did this several times in the past without any problems. So he had enough money to gamble, but not enough money for the hotel room. Leroy believed that Charisse's brother was watching her. In reality, nobody was attending to Charisse. She was wandering around the arcade alone. Jeremy Strohmeyer started playing with Charisse. They were throwing paper towels at each other. At 3:48 a.m., Charisse entered a woman's restroom, presumably to get more paper towels. Jeremy entered the restroom as well. About a minute later, David entered. David would later report that he saw Jeremy and Charisse throwing wet paper towels at each other. Then Jeremy took Charisse into one of the stalls. David entered an adjacent stall and looked over the partition to see what Jeremy was doing. He saw Jeremy committing an assault of a sexual nature. Jeremy was threatening Charisse, telling her to be quiet, or he would murder her. David said he tapped Jeremy on the head because Jeremy's behavior was out of character. Jeremy just gave him a blank stare. David said that at no time did he verbally tell Jeremy to stop. Rather, David just stared at Jeremy in a way where Jeremy should have known that David wanted him to stop. So these two were just staring at each other. David did not say anything. David exited the restroom about 2 minutes after he entered. Jeremy exited about 22 minutes later. Jeremy told David that he had murdered Charisse. After this, Jeremy and David went to other casinos where they played slot machines and rode on roller coasters. They then returned to California. David never reported Jeremy's activity to the police. He said that he knew Jeremy's day of reckoning was coming, and he didn't want to be the one to turn him in. Jeremy was identified on the surveillance video. The police arrested him 3 days after the murder. He was charged with a number of crimes, including first-degree murder. He admitted to the police that he strangled Charisse and attempted to break her neck. Jeremy would eventually plead guilty to 4 felonies. He was sentenced to 4 consecutive life terms in October of 1998. Jeremy has appealed his convictions several times unsuccessfully. He has made a number of accusations. He tried to say that David was actually the killer, even though the video surveillance reveals that David was only in the bathroom for 2 minutes, as compared to Jeremy, who was in there for 25 minutes. Jeremy accused his attorney of coercing him into pleading guilty. His attorney was none other than Leslie Abramson, who famously represented the Menendez brothers. It doesn't appear as though Jeremy is happy in prison. I guess the prison where Jeremy is housed is on the way to yet another 1-star review on the prison satisfaction survey. David Cash was severely criticized for his failure to report or intervene. People couldn't believe he could witness the attack and just pretend nothing happened. The police were unable to do anything to him because he had not violated the law. Students at Berkeley started a campaign to get him expelled from the school. University officials said they couldn't punish him because he had not been convicted of any crime. People started referring to David Cash as the Bad Samaritan. During an interview on a radio show, David said, quote, "It's a very tragic event, okay. How much am I supposed to sit down and cry about this? I mean, let's be reasonable here. Is my life supposed to halt for, like, days, weeks, and months on end? The simple fact remains, I do not know this little girl. I do not know starving children in Panama. I do not know people who die of disease in Egypt. The only person I knew in this event was Jeremy Strohmeyer, and I know as his best friend that he had potential. I'm sad I lost a best friend." Unquote. On 60 Minutes, David made a few more interesting statements. He claimed he didn't report the crime because he never thought anything bad would happen to Charisse. He did not think her life was in danger. David talked about how he could have gotten in trouble if he went back in the bathroom after he realized Jeremy was in there for a long time. Like a situation where maybe he didn't recognize what was happening in the moment, but he certainly must have recognized it after Jeremy remained in there. So David was saying that it was really unsafe for him to go back in after that time elapsed because people might think that he was involved. David said his failure to report the crime does not weigh on his conscience as much as people would like it to. When asked what he would do differently if he could go back in time, David said he doesn't feel there is much he could have done differently. David told a newspaper in Long Beach that he wanted to sell his story to the media. He said, quote, "I am no idiot. I'll blank get money out of this," unquote. David graduated from Berkeley in 2001 with a bachelor's degree in nuclear engineering. Now moving to my analysis. The actions of David Cash have been difficult for people to understand, and his behavior raises a number of questions. Like, should society try to create laws to force people to report certain crimes? First, I'll talk about the behavior of David Cash, then I'll talk about what society should or could do in response. What was David Cash thinking during this incident? Why did he behave this way? The reality is, we will never know for sure, but there are a few possibilities that come up. This is just my opinion. Often in situations where somebody fails to report a serious crime, they immediately feel guilty. When they witness the crime, they may have been scared, confused, or uncertain about what was happening. It might be only later on when they realized they should have done something. Those conditions don't really apply to this case. David didn't have any reason to be scared, no reason to be confused, and it was clear he knew what was happening. It would appear that David either did not have any empathy, or he chose not to act on it. His later statements imply that only people that he knows should be afforded any compassion or protection. He did not know Charisse. He doesn't know a lot of people who have died. Therefore, in his view, he owes them nothing. In order for somebody to be a human and to have value, they must be known by David Cash. This appears to be what he believed. As I mentioned, David did not feel empathy, or he chose not to act on those feelings. He was disconnected from the suffering of Charisse and felt loyalty to his friend. He understood that Jeremy's behavior was criminal, but didn't want to jeopardize that friendship. Charisse's life simply wasn't worth enough to David to warrant some type of intervention. David's behavior in that casino was reprehensible, but he continued to be offensive after the fact. There is a second stage to his behavior that also defies belief. If David had immediately recognized what he did was wrong, if he acknowledged that he made a terrible mistake, that wouldn't bring Charisse back, but at least it would look like David had some remorse, like he'd learned something. But that's not what happened. Instead, David appeared to be inconvenienced and perturbed that people were upset with his behavior. His reaction to criticism is actually remarkably consistent with his failure to help Charisse. David is disconnected. He doesn't have empathy for Charisse, and he doesn't have empathy for people who criticize him. So he doesn't understand what anyone is feeling. He understands what he is feeling only. He truly doesn't understand what he did was wrong. It doesn't make sense to him why anybody would be judging him. He can't understand that other people have empathy and that he does not. There appears to be a lack of insight. This case appears to be a good example of how somebody can be very intelligent, but not in touch with other people's feelings. David's view of the world seems to be legalistic and self-centered. He didn't technically commit a crime, therefore, he doesn't want to be punished. He had the right to fail to act. He doesn't feel guilt or shame, so why are other people demanding that feeling from him? Again, I believe that David is genuinely confused. He really does not understand. His behavior has been consistent from the very beginning. I don't think David is lying. He doesn't feel the need to be deceptive. He didn't try to say that he was afraid of Jeremy. He did not make an excuse that might be marginally acceptable to the public. Instead, he told the truth. That is, he is not ashamed of his behavior, and he wouldn't do anything differently. There is zero remorse. Moving to the next question, how should society respond to this? The actions of David Cash led to new legislation in Nevada and California that makes it a crime not to report situations like the one David witnessed. There are a few other states that also have this duty to rescue or duty to report type law. Many prosecutors and defense attorneys disagree with these laws, saying that it's just an attempt to legislate morality. This case taps into something interesting as far as the relationship between morality and the law. In theory, every time a crime is committed, it is also a moral violation. But not every moral violation is a crime. Most criminal laws involve someone acting as opposed to failing to act. What's more, many of the laws that deal with inaction involve people who were obligated to take action through their job or position, but did not. For example, if a parent fails to provide shelter for a child, that could be a crime. But if a neighbor to that child fails to provide shelter to them, that would not be a crime. The neighbor has not taken on that obligation. There is no expectation they will act. No one is counting on them. This is where the duty to rescue law gets tricky. Citizens generally have the right to do nothing. Some people are exceedingly good at it. Doing nothing is what they do best. An example of appropriate inaction would be asserting the right to remain silent. This is always the best move for someone being questioned by the police. But with these duty to rescue laws, now people are compelled to communicate with the police under certain circumstances. Critics of these laws have a few complaints. The laws are vague. They punish character instead of conduct. They take away freedom. They will generate false reports because people will be worried about not reporting something and go overboard. They will not actually discourage inaction, and they are expensive and problematic to prosecute. For example, the laws do not require a report if there is any risk to the citizen. One could argue there is always risk when reporting a crime. If the duty to rescue and duty to report laws are problematic, what should society do? Is there another answer? What society needs is more empathy and less narcissism. The homicide that occurred in this case was a long time in the making. It was a failure at multiple levels. Leroy left Charisse unattended repeatedly. Jeremy murdered her. And David Cash looked the other way. The destructive and unhelpful elements of their personalities formed over many years, not when the people were at the casino. Unfortunately, no laws can create empathy or eradicate narcissism. No threat of punishment is great enough to accomplish these goals. In order to keep society safe, people who have empathy and who are not narcissistic must be vigilant. They alone are burdened with compensating for those who will happily stand by and do nothing. Those are my thoughts on the case of David Cash Jr. Please put any opinions and thoughts in the comment section. They always generate an interesting dialogue. As always, I hope you found my analysis on this topic to be informative. Thanks for watching.